In the last few videos, we have designed this out-of-order pipeline, and I'm going to touch upon one last topic of multithreading before I move on to other aspects of the process, such as the memory hierarchy. Okay, so this pipeline that we designed, if you look at your processor chip, you know, all of this can be accommodated in a very small fraction of the total chip area. Okay, and this is referred to as a single core. Okay, and now we have enough room on the chip to have many of these cores. Okay, and each core can execute its own independent thread, because each core will have its own, you know, branch prediction and instruction fetch unit, its own program counter, and so on. So each core is capable of handling its own independent thread. There's also some space on the chip to store caches, which are shared by many of the cores. Okay, so all of these cores are going to share the data that is stored in these caches. And much later, we'll talk about, you know, how to ensure that every core sees a consistent view of data. Okay, so, you know, this is one way to increase the number of threads on your processor, but just having many different cores and having each one execute its own thread. And this is called the chip multiprocessor, or, you know, more or the more common term is to just refer to this as a multi-core processor. Okay, so, you know, there are multiple strategies for thread-level parallelism, that is to provide more parallelism in your processor by having multiple threads. One, as I just said, is the CMP, or the multi-core approach. The second option is to have multiple threads running together on the same core, and that's called simultaneous multithreading. And the reason you want to do this is because if you look at how a single core itself behaves, you'll notice that it is heavily underutilized a lot of the times. Okay, so for example, you may have built a core with an issue width of, say, 4. If you look at how many times all the 4 slots are utilized, you'll see that this happens very rarely. Okay, so there will be some portions of the program where there is a large amount of ILP. There are many instructions that are independent of each other and that can execute together. And in those cycles, you'll see that, you know, all the 4 ALUs are being utilized. You're, you know, fetching, decoding, committing 4 instructions every single cycle. But then you enter these other phases of the program where the level of ILP is relatively low. So many cycles go by where you can only find maybe, you know, 0, 1, or 2 instructions to execute. So the processor is heavily underutilized. And this means that, you know, maybe there are all these resources that are going idle, and maybe they can be put to good use if you are feeding instructions from multiple threads to those execution units. Okay, so that is the whole motivation for trying to say that, you know, if I build a processor with issue width of 4, the average utilization, or the average IPC, is usually, you know, around 1.5. That means, you know, every single cycle, on average, 2.5 of the units are going underutilized. So instead, if I ran 2 threads together, each thread would have an IPC of close to 1.5. The net effect would be that my average IPC, my average total IPC, would be, you know, close to 3.0. Okay, so this is the whole motivation for wanting to cram 2 different threads into the same core. Okay, here's another pictorial view of this. Okay, so this is the process that we've designed so far. These processes are referred to as superscalar processes because they can handle multiple instructions in the same cycle. And, you know, as I said, there are some cycles where you could find, you know, 3 instructions to issue, but then there are many other cycles where you find, you know, 0 or, you know, 2 or even 1 instruction to issue, right? So all these white blocks represent underutilization, and maybe you can fill in those slots if you are feeding instructions from multiple threads. Okay, so, you know, there are multiple ways to do that. One is called fine-grained multithreading, where every single cycle, the hardware will pick one of the 4 threads, let's say, to issue an instruction from. Okay, so in the first cycle, it was a turn of the green thread. In the second cycle, it was the turn of the red thread, then the gray thread, and so on. Okay, and then, you know, it's not very hard to quickly go from this model of multithreading to what is called simultaneous multithreading, where every single cycle, it is fair game to execute an instruction from any of the 4 threads. Okay, and this gives you your best chances of trying to fill all of these idle slots. Okay, so you'll see that here there are only, you know, 2 idle slots. That means in any given cycle, you know, for example, here I was able to find, you know, 3 green instructions, 1 red instruction. In the next cycle, there were, you know, 2 red, 1 green, 1 yellow, and so on. Okay, so this is known as simultaneous multithreading, where if you're fetching from 4 different threads, you can execute an instruction from any of those threads in any given cycle, and that gives the issue queue the best chance of finding, say, 4 instructions to issue in that next cycle. Okay, so, you know, let's see how you would design this processor. Okay, so, you know, I said that here's a core that is shared by many threads, But within that core, you know, do some resources have to be private to each thread? And, you know, do some resources have to be shared? You know, let's look at how you would discriminate between different resources. Okay, so for correctness, every thread will need its own program counter, right? There's no way for many threads to share the same program counter because each thread is doing something different. It's independent, perhaps, of each other. So every thread needs its own program counter, its own, you know, instruction fetch queue to keep track of the fact that, you know, these are the instructions this program has fetched. So when this thread refers to R1, it refers to, you know, this earlier producer instruction. Okay, so you need to make sure that you treat the instructions from one thread as being from that one thread. Otherwise, you will confuse, you know, producers and consumers from different threads. Each thread will also need its own set of, you know, logical or architecture registers because every thread believes it has access to, say, 32 registers, and those are the registers named in the program's binary. Okay, so you'll refer to, you know, R1, R3, all the way up to R32. And so every thread, you know, needs to have those 32 registers allocated in the register file. And then there may be some more extra registers, which can be used for renaming and for bringing in new instructions into the pipeline. Okay, so likewise, every thread will also need its own mappings from logical to physical registers. Okay, so each thread will have, you know, its own program counter, its own instruction fetch queue, its own rename tables, so that it can keep track of, you know, what is its speculative map table, what is its committed map table. And then, you know, for the sake of performance, you might also want to separate some other structures, such as the reorder buffer and the load store queue. Okay, so usually the reorder buffer is separated for every single thread. Okay, because, you know, just because one thread is stalled waiting for some memory operation, you don't want to stall commit for other threads. Okay, so usually every thread is given its own reorder buffer, so that, you know, one long latency instruction does not stall the entire pipeline. It only stalls that one thread. Okay, but everything else in the processor can be shared. Okay, so there are things like the caches, the instruction cache and the data cache, which we will discuss shortly, the branch predictor, and then the functional units and the ALUs, all of those are shared freely. Okay, so here's another way of looking at it. Okay, so, you know, every thread needs its own front end. And by front end, I mean, you know, the process of fetching and renaming instructions. Okay, you know, this has to be done very carefully. You can't get confused between different threads, as I said, right? Every thread will need its own program counter. You will bring in those instructions. You have to make sure that you understand that, you know, these instructions belong to the same thread. That allows you to make sure that you clearly define what the producer and consumers are. That allows you to do, you know, precise renaming. And so, you know, all of that is being done by the front end, and that is private to every single thread. Okay, and that's what I'm showing here. So you have your branch predictor and cache, which need not be private. They could be shared. And then there is the rename tables, and, you know, this includes things like the program counter, IFQ, and so on. All of those have to be private to every single thread. Okay, and so once you bring in instructions, once you figure out how you're going to handle them, you then place them in a shared execution engine, which includes things like the issue queue. It also includes the load store queue. There's a shared pool of registers. There's a shared pool of functional units and a data cache. Okay, so all of these instructions enter the issue queue. And at that point, you don't have to discriminate between threads, right? Because every thread has already figured out, you know, who the producers and consumers are. Accordingly, you've done register renaming. Okay, so now, you know, an instruction belonging to, say, the green thread is only going to refer to results produced by other, say, green instructions. Okay, so, you know, once you enter the execution engine, the issue queue really doesn't keep track of, you know, who belongs to each thread. The assumption is that the renaming has been done correctly. So at this point, the issue queue is shared among all the threads. The issue queue picks out a few instructions to issue every cycle. They could be any combination of, you know, green, red, yellow, and gray threads. And then those instructions get to execute on the shared pool of functional units. They write the results into the shared register file, and so on. Okay, here's another way of looking at it. So I'm just dealing with two threads in this example. Here's my shared physical register file. Okay, and at first, you know, I have to assign 32 registers to thread 1 and 32 registers to thread 2. Okay, so these first 32 registers are mapped to thread 1. So, you know, R1 is mapped to P1, R2 is mapped to P2, and so on. These next 32 registers are mapped to the second thread. So R1 for the second thread is mapped to P33, R2 is mapped to P34, and so on. Okay, so the free pool would be everything from this point on. So, you know, P65 until, let's say, you know, P128. Let's assume this is a really large register file. So the last 64 registers are assumed to be part of the free pool. So as instructions come in, they're assigned registers from the free pool. Okay, so for example, you know, R1 gets renamed to P65, R3 gets renamed to P66, and so on. Likewise, for thread 2, R2 gets renamed to P76, and so on. Okay, so once you get put in the issue queue, in this case, I've color-coded them as, you know, being from the blue thread or the red thread. But the issue queue really doesn't care about, you know, whether this is blue thread or red thread, because it makes sure that the renaming is such that when you refer to P65, you will refer to a value produced by a blue thread. Okay, so there's no way for an instruction from the red thread to refer to register values that may have been produced by the blue thread, right? The renaming makes sure that you have your own set of registers and your map tables, and you will never get confused in terms of register names. Okay, so the issue queue looks like this, and you know, it can have instructions from multiple threads. And in any given cycle, if you know these two are ready and say these two are ready, those instructions will just get to issue together, right? So you really don't make a distinction between red and blue threads.